القدوتم اللساني يفقه قولي واجعلني وزيرا من أهلي أمين يا رب العالمين.
First of all, it's a great honor to be here, alhamdulillah.
And JazakAllah khairan to Imam Uthman, wherever he is, I can see him right now. I don't know. Yeah, okay, he's there. So, he's Imam, so he's the, alhamdulillah, the center of attraction for the community, or he should be, inshallah. First, we will start with the dua, where he introduced me, but Allah knows my reality. So he only told the positive things and my academics. But I'm a very sinful person and I'm not very knowledgeable. So I'm not here because I'm the most knowledgeable or because I'm the most pious. Indeed, I'm very sinful and I'm ignorant. So make dua for me also. Allahumma la tu'akhizni bima yaqulun wa ja'alni khayrun mimma yazunnun waghfir li bima la ya'lamun. This is a dua which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and other narration Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu taught us. Whenever someone praises you, you need to ask this dua. Oh Allah, please make me better than their assumption and please do not hold me accountable for whatever they are saying, because they don't know my private life. Okay, the need of this topic, gender interaction, he didn't tell where my the field of my bachelor's. He told my master's in this, my inshallah, my doctorate inshallah will be in Quran, but my bachelor's was in fashion designing, which is very important to tell regarding this topic. So I have been into the school of fashion designing, and then I have been into the extremely conservative orthodox religious environment in Pakistan also. So I have seen one extreme and the other extreme, and then even still I'm studying, and all of us have to be student until the death. But I was trying to figure out, as he was mentioning, where is the fine balance taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, we all came from different countries, from Pakistan, from Bangladesh, from Saudi, from Egypt here, alhamdulillah. And you will notice one thing, out of many differences in terms of apparent Islam, which these cultures will have, is that they have same Quran, same Sunnah, maybe different school of thought, but they will apply on the base of cultural value. So priorities which a Pakistani Imam or the Saudi Imam or the Egyptian Imam is teaching there in the local culture might be different because of the local issues. But the problem is, once we come here in this country, without realizing what is the concern of masses, we will try to apply the same value, let's say Pakistani Islam or the Pakistani priority or Egyptian priority or Malaysian priority, without understanding what are the needs of Muslim here in America. So I'll give you a few examples before we can start the topic. So if we were going to discuss about saying Ameen louder or slower, that might not be very, very wise thing to discuss, as compared to our kids are getting confused and they are becoming agnostic and atheist, so forth. That is one thing which we have to discuss. Are we getting the point? So in terms of priorities, our things need to be changed. Even this topic is very important. We are not living in the idealistic Muslim society where boys go in separate school, girls have a separate school. Just like in some Muslim countries, you will have. Although they are changing also. So we need to tell them how to interact with opposite gender. One blunt statement comes from the parent, "Shh, don't talk to sisters, it's haram." And then other liberal side will come, "Do whatever you want. Whatever you want. There is no restriction." So where is the middle path? What are the guidelines? And then we will tell that one female companion will come to Rasulullah ﷺ and ask this question, very straightforward, blunt question, and Rasulullah ﷺ would answer that question. And on the other end, you are saying, "No, don't talk to sisters." Where is the balance? Especially this happened with the daughters. You will say, "Don't talk to the guys." And once she's going to Sunday school or any other Islamic school, or she's talking to Imam, Imam is a guy. And then you will tell the same hadith that Ansar Sahabiyat used to ask very open questions to Rasulullah. So there is a confusion, as he was using the word hypocrisy, that there is some sort of confusion in our minds, and especially in our kids' mind. So that's why this topic is very important in this society. What we will do, inshallah, I usually give a class of 3-4 hour class on fiqh of gender interaction. I will try to summarize all the major things in few minutes, inshallah. But again, this topic won't be complete in just few minutes. So if you have any question regarding anything, you can ask, inshallah. Before I can start, one more disclaimer. Please, if you can fulfill one sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam right now. What is that sunnah? Sunnah of a smile. Can you all smile? Yeah, don't give me this look of death, please. Okay, so let us start, alhamdulillah. You know, there are two approaches in terms of gender interaction, as I just brought it up. One is extremely conservative, more than religion is asking you to do. that there are four or five brothers sitting in the masjid or in a Muslim community, and they would not even take the name of a woman. It's haram to them even to take the name of a woman. Like four or five brothers are sitting, Muhammad, Ahmad, so forth, and they would take the name of Aisha. They would say, astaghfirullah lazeem, Aisha, we have to do something, we have to do wudu again. That's one mentality. I don't know how this mentality came, because Quran takes the name of a woman, that's Maryam alayhi salam. Some scholars say that because of Isa alayhi salam birth, that's why Maryam name is there. But actually one ayah was there without his mention, and that's Waskur fil kitabi Maryam idhin tabazat min ahliha makanan shaqiya. So I don't know how that group recite these ayat. Maybe they will recite like Waskur fil kitabi Maryam astaghfirullah alazim idhin tabazat min ahliha makanan shaqiya. That's one. And I'm not joking, wallahi, I have been the imam in this country. I know Imam Uthman have witnessed that, that there are group of brothers or sisters in other way around also who have that mentality, that talking to other or opposite gender is haram completely. That's not true. And on the other extreme, you will find a group of, I don't want to use the word liberal, but that kind of people who will say everything is halal. As they say, all good in the hood, do whatever you want. So there is no restriction, nothing, you have to keep nice intention, do whatever you want. No, there are some restrictions. What are those guidelines which are taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? If you follow culture, we won't last, because this America is made by immigrants. Muslims are coming from Pakistan, Muslims are coming from Egypt, Muslims are coming from Turkey. If you will apply Pakistani culture of gender interaction, Egyptian brother or sister might not be comfortable. And obviously that might not be acceptable to Allah also. Allah is asking us to apply Quran and Sunnah, and vice versa. If you will apply Saudi culture, the Indian brother or sister might not be happy. So what we have to do, apply Quran and Sunnah, and all the Muslims have to follow that. Okay, what are the guidelines given by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Quran in terms of gender interaction? We are going to see this, and then I'm going to move to a very sensitive topic, if I will have time. If any guy or a girl in the college start liking each other, then what they have to do, Islamically, inshallah. First of all, gender interaction. There are, if you will ask me to explain in a layman language, there are four things. Four things which all of us have to remember. Whether we are interacting with any opposite gender in masjid, or in public, or in school, college, university, workplace, in market, malls. Just remember these four things. First thing, actually before I can say, let's make this interactive, because that's what I said to you, Imam Uthman. What do you think, what we have to keep in mind when we are talking to an opposite gender? Tell me. If you won't say, you won't get the food. Is your food ready? Okay, alhamdulillah. You won't get the food. Tell me. Yes. Oh yeah. Just raise your hand, please. Very good, mashallah. Lower your gaze. So first thing is, we have to have a respectful gaze. G-A-Z-E. Respectful gaze. Okay, now Allah says in Surah An-Nur, ayat number 30 and 31, to both man and woman, we have to keep our gaze lower. There are many opinions about this. What do you mean when I'm driving the car, I should lower my gaze all the time? No. Gaze means sight. When I'm looking at someone, I have to keep that gaze lower in certain circumstances. And what are those circumstances? When you're looking at the opposite gender, so now ulama give different opinions. First opinion by the orthodox mufassirun about that ayah of Surah An-Nur is that you have to keep your gaze lower all the time when you see an opposite gender. When you don't see, how you can keep your gaze up. That is one opinion. Other opinion is, no, you have to keep your gaze lower, and you can see face, but you cannot see privates of opposite gender. Third opinion about this ayah is that you can see on the face of each other, as long as wrong thought does not come in your mind. And everyone knows his weaknesses or her weakness, then keep your gaze lower. So there are multiple opinions, and they are coming from all the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah scholars. I'm not quoting you any opinion outside of the pale of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Okay, what we have to do? We have to teach this to our kids, that make sure when you're looking at the opposite gender, you're looking at in a respectful way. You're not looking at and checking each and everything, honestly speaking. That's what people do. So the first thing we have to do when you're talking to opposite gender in a school, in college, working in a group projects, in assignment, or whether you are working in a job, make sure the gaze are respectful, the sight is respectful. Is it clear? And now the question will come, how can we keep our gaze lower when she's teaching us or she's working with us? So you can follow second opinion. You can see wherever it's necessary on the face, but at the same time, just make sure there's no shahwa, there's no desire. As soon as you will feel something wrong, just keep your gaze lower. And where it's necessary to make an eye contact at the interview, so forth, then you can do, because that's even, there are a few opinions from these scholars there. So that's one thing which you have to keep in mind. Okay, apart from respectful gaze or respectful sight, what else we need to remember when we are talking to opposite gender? Apart from Imam Usman. Yeah, tell me. Anything, can we get any feedback? Because I think most of the audience right now, I don't know, you are here right now mentally?
Yeah.
Or, because there's a game going on right now, I guess. Okay, tell. Okay, I will tell you. I don't know what, how to make you more interactive. So second thing which you have to remember is that when you are talking to an opposite gender, make sure that talk is useful, not useless. Useless conversation is not permissible with opposite gender. Or make sure that's professional, not personal. When is professional? Rasulullah's profession was a messenger. So he asked all those questions which female companions asked. He didn't say, no, I won't answer this. Astaghfirullah. And many times this question was so sensitive, he used Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha. Okay, you can take her and explain this to her. But many times he would answer himself. He would teach to the female companions once a week. But that's professional, not personal. That's useful, not useless. So when it comes to something useful, you can have interaction. If someone comes from a mentality from the first group, which I just mentioned, they say, no, it's haram, this guy is talking to a woman. No, it's not haram just by talking or not talking. What he's talking. And then obviously, everyone knows his or her circumstances about professional or personal. And it depends on culture also. It depends on culture also. So let's say if you are in Walmart and the sister at the cashier register, she says you, have a nice day. And you think, no, it's astaghfirullah. How can I wish her back? You will say, yeah, I will. That's rude. You have to say, yeah, likewise. You too. That's not personal. But if the same thing is applied in, let's say, Saudi or Pakistan or Yemen, which is fairly conservative, then the thing, that equation might be changed. So again, the cultural values have to be there. But obviously, cultural values have to be there as long as you are for playing within the lines of Quran and Sunnah. I will come to that shaking hand also, inshallah. But that's the second thing. As far as conversation is concerned, it has to be useful, not useless. Can you give me an example in workplace or in college or in school? How?
What is the basis of this opinion that it should be only...
From the entire conversation of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the female companions, we can take that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did communicate with the female companions, but all that communication was useful, not useless. For useless communication, where you try to spend some time, or where you have to joke around with your friend, you'd have to do with your own same gender. There are books written by the scholars. One book is written by, it was translated by Sheikh Hatim Al-Hajj recently, Fiqh of Gender Interaction. And there are a few books in Arabic. If you can ask, I can give you the references. I'm just giving you the nutshell of the entire books.
Can we say that by useful means necessity?
Yeah. And that's, so,
for me, it would be useful.
Yeah, there are many things. I told you there are 4-hour session I gave. It's very hard for me. If I will give reference of this point, I will skip many others. So I'm giving a summary, and make dua that I'll come again, or maybe Imam Uthman, inshallah, he can elaborate that one more. But one example is Surah Al-Qasas. Musa alayhi salam is having communication with the two daughters of that person. Remember, in Surah Al-Qasas, that was useful conversation. And then Sulaiman alayhi salam also, Maryam alayhi salam also. Yeah, so there are dozens of examples, but obviously, since again, I am very shrinked, I have to give that 4-hour talk in 40 minutes, but inshallah, I can provide you references. But again, see, something which I said, if that's wrong, you can ask me question, inshallah, you don't have to agree with me. And if you'll ask me question, I won't feel bad, inshallah. But these are the two things which you in common sense agree. You have to keep a respectful gaze. Make sure they reduce the...
About it also, I have some doubt. Look, you know, it seems only the face is the attractive part.
Yeah.
Actually, There are many more things people are affecting in the
world. Yeah.
So I really don't see the point of keep the eye away from the face.
Yeah.
Actually, you will be seeing, looking at more attractive parts.
That's why I'm saying second opinion. Follow second opinion. What's wrong with it? So there are 3-4 opinions. You can follow any opinion what you want, and they all are coming from the authentic scholars. And problem is not that we have to follow first opinion rigidly and decline all the opinions. Problem is we can follow whatever opinion I want. If I'm talking to old woman, I can see her face because that might not be attractive. If I'm single, I'm young, hormones are raging, and I'm talking to my classmate who is young, I might follow that lower the gaze. And we know the attraction. If you ask any young guy who's in that age, he can tell you, she can tell you how it plays part, because Allah says, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَ يَغُدُّونَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِ وَيَحْفَظُ فُرُوجَهُمْ. Shaitan will enter from Absar. The next thing is, it will come out from the private part in Surah An-Nur, number 30. But anyway, so second thing is, if you have any question, you can ask after the conversation. Please let me finish, inshallah. Okay, so first thing was, where first thing was? Lower or have a respectful gaze. Second, useful conversation. Any example? Yeah, actually, I wanted to ask you, you asked me questions. Yeah, so can you tell me what kind of conversation will be useful? Yes, mashallah. So if you have a group project in work and you are discussing something about the project, that's useful. If you are in college and school and if you are asking, can I have this pen, that might be useful. But if you take the project and if you take the flower and if you take the pen and you will say, wow, what a beautiful pen. That's conversation going in direction of south. And each and everyone know their weakness, their heart, that when I'm taking the conversation to the direction of south. Have a respectful conversation. You can have it, that's permissible. But everyone knows their intention of saying this statement, what I am intending. Maybe young guys especially, nowadays typing or the social media, when you're writing LOL to an opposite gender, or when you're writing LOL, by the way, does not mean la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. LOL means something else. Yeah, you will ask me evidence for that, I don't know, subhanAllah. LMFAO and all these things. So your intention have to be there. Your intention have to be there that, why I'm doing this? If my intention is not clear, stay away. That's unpermissible. So second thing is make sure your conversation is as long as useful, it's okay. Third thing which you have to remember when you're talking to sister or opposite gender is that make sure there's no physical contact as much as you can. As much as you can. I mean, intentionally it happens, Allah will forgive, inshallah. But intentionally, you just stay away. We all know the ahadith and the sayings that Prophet Muhammad says, if the nail of a steel is smashed in your hair, just take that and do not touch the woman, because the day of judgment, the punishment for that is more intense than that nail will be smashed on your head. SubhanAllah, that's a terrifying hadith. But that's with intentional. That's with intentional. Unintentionally, if you're giving money to the toll, sister sending a toll, or the brother at the cash register, sister is giving, let's say, money, and her part of finger touches him, it does not mean that she have to just cut that part of finger and throw it away. Wallahi, don't do that. Many people ask this. Generally, shaking hand is not permissible. But let's say if your own weakness, you did that. Because I know I have worked 5 months in Gap. So I'm telling you, Gap and Old Navy. So I'm telling you, sometime you're surrounded by that circumstances and your iman is weak, you will do that. So it does not mean that you have done shirk. Just make dua, Allah will forgive you, move on, inshallah. Allah will going to ask you based on your environment and based on your ability, how you apply Quran and Sunnah. So try to apply Quran and Sunnah as much as you can. But if something happened, inshallah, seek forgiveness, move forward, inshallah. So that's the third thing, avoid physical contact. This includes high fives in college and school and all, everything. Okay, the fourth thing to remember. What was the first thing? Respectful gaze. Second, conversation have to be professional, not personal. There are exceptions to this. So exceptions is if Imam is sitting for counseling and some sister is coming, he or she have to ask some personal questions for counseling so that they can give the answer. But generally speaking, a brother and sister in college, in work, in masjid, they cannot have personal conversation. Because personal conversation will open the heart for emotional attachment. And then obviously further things will happen. So have conversation professionally. Fourth thing to remember about gender interaction is that avoid as much as you can private conversation with opposite gender. We all know the hadith that if guy and a girl is talking, who is the third one? Yeah. And we don't have to see the shaitan. Who is shaitan here with me and her with two horns? No, that's a shaitan in movie and Bollywood and Hollywood. Shaitan in this hadith is actually, you have to feel this shaitan when you are alone with any opposite gender. Shaitan will whisper in your ears, that why don't you take the next step? Why don't you do this? Why don't you do this? And eventually, you might do all those bad things. That's Shaitan will whisper in your ears. So that these are the four things which we have to remember about gender interaction. Generally, why I'm giving you these principles? Because it is permissible to talk to an opposite gender. Quran has said so many times, Maryam alayhi salam was talking to a guy who came, remember in Surah Maryam? Yusuf alayhi salam was talking to Zulaikha. He was advising even at that time when she was asking her, but he was already moving away. But he could have said, no, talking is haram. Talking is permissible, but there are a few guidelines. So Sulaiman alayhi salam is talking to Malika Saba, and there are many other ahadith as brother was mentioning. But yeah, these are the guidelines. Make sure the conversation does not go and cross certain limits. Okay, there are a few details which I have to tell you about few of these principles. Especially young brothers and sisters. I don't know whether the young sisters are there, but few young brothers are here, alhamdulillah. Make sure when you are applying this principle of useful and useless, you don't do too much joking with opposite gender. Because jokes will open the door for the emotional attachment. You might ask, what's the problem with emotional attachment? I will give the rational and logical answer also. But the first thing is, for joking, you have your own gender, same gender. One problem with our society is that we have free mixing, as I said. We are not living in the idealistic Islamic society. So the joking, the everything, ask us or force us or encourage us to take the next step, because joke you can use as icebreakers and then eventually you take the next step. So make sure when you, in terms of joking or showing your humor, it's the same gender, not the opposite gender. But on the other extreme, don't be insulting and disrespectful. Like if you're talking to a sister, what happened? Why you're talking to me? Don't you know it's haram? Don't do that. No one is asking you to do. So again, try to be as moderate as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm using the word moderate in non-Urdu concept, because I know in some Urdu speaking countries this word moderate was misused by some of the politicians. It was used for enlightened moderate Islam, which is away from the traditional Islam, but moderate is actually the mu'tadil way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you must make sure that you are taking care of the jokes. There are few ahadiths where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would joke around with the female companions, elderly. Remember that camel incident and then other incident. But in that case, you will see they both were not single. And then they both were not very young. So there are many factors were playing. And they were not doing that in private. They were doing in public. And they all were related can I go to Jannah? No, not an old woman. They're all Islamic teaching also. So there are many aspects of those jokes. But if a young man and young woman sitting in private in Dunkin' Donuts and they're using this hadith for joking around, that might not be a good application. Is it clear? So these are the four things which we can erect from Quran and Sunnah. Let's take, before I can move on to the other things about gender interaction, is there anything you want to share, add, comment? Just like one brother was sharing his experience. Can anyone else have question before we can move on? No one. In the middle, you were asking so many questions. Yes, Imam Uthman. Oh yeah, subhanAllah. See, I forgot. Allah jazakallah khairan. First of all, you can tell whatever. No, tell me.
No, just the social media aspect of the four
guidelines. Yeah, it's so important, but subhanAllah, I don't know why I forgot this. But anyway, so social media. Back in the days when we applied the fourth principle that a guy and a girl should not meet in private, meeting should be in public, the explanation of the hadith was different, but now we have social media. Now we have Facebook, now we have Twitter, now we have Snapchat, now we have DJ Khaled, right? if older people, if you don't know DJ Khaled, that's okay, alhamdulillah. For the younger guys, you can say astaghfirullah alazim, yeah.
My name is Khaled.
Your name is Khaled? Yeah, mashallah. May Allah make you like Khaled bin Walid, radiyallahu anhu. I mean, so where I was, it's social media. Anyway, you have WhatsApp and this. Is a smartphone, but wallahi, sometimes we are not smart enough to use the smartphone because our smartness is shrinked. So how to use social media and how to apply that interaction or say a ruling that don't meet in private. So if you are texting or emailing the sister in your college, in school, at work, I would prefer a few things. First, if you are single, don't text her alone, or she should not text you alone. Let's make a group chat. Whether it's WhatsApp, whether it's email, even if it's for a project, keep anyone else from your family or from her family, keep anyone else in a group email or group chat. See how a straight conversation will go. Because things will start very from a very small thing. So you will make a smiley face, she will write LOL, and you will feel something. Then eventually emotional attachment will happen. But if you are keeping someone in CC, or if you're keeping someone in group chat, then conversation will go straight. But in business world, if you're surrounded by the interaction with sisters, then sometimes it's impossible to do that. Let's say, I'll tell you my own example. Usually I receive, on average, 100 to 150 text messages from sisters or from brother sisters every day, and most of them are sisters because brothers can talk to me usually on the Masallah and so forth. Some of them are from Pakistan because every year I go twice or thrice in Pakistan to speak in different universities, and some of them are locally from different states. So now what I have to do, it's impossible, nearly impossible for me to keep my wife, I usually use my wife for this, to keep my wife on each and every text. So in the business world, what you can do to substitute this, in business world, you can just, like, I ask my wife that, okay, you can check my cell phone, this is the password of my Gmail and Facebook, you can check, and you have to check once in a week, twice in a week, and if there's something wrong, let me know. And vice versa is the principle. This is very important, because when Rasulullah said, when you're talking with an opposite gender, third one is shaitan, we can't ignore this. So there's small butterflies flying around your belly, that's very natural. So that's one thing which you have to keep in mind in social media. So especially when in college and in school, and when you're single, make sure you're using group chat, inshallah. It's something which is preferable, not something which is obligatory. But sometimes preferable things can prevent you and protect you from haram and makruh things, inshallah. Okay, let's discuss any other thing about these principles. Yes.
Well, you know, you said that do not have, men and women should not have any private conversation except for work related.
Yeah.
But that completely precludes the possibility of a man or woman to find a suitable husband.
That's a very good question.
So I think then it leaves only arranged marriages.
Yeah.
May not be. I had an arranged marriage, but I think there are.
Okay. Yeah. If you will just wait for 10-15 minutes, I will talk about love and arranged marriage, how it's possible in American Muslim community. I will answer this question, inshallah. But that's a very important question. And remind me if I forget, inshallah. Okay. Let's move on to the next thing. Let's say I use this actually as a proactive approach in Muslim community. But let's say if one guy in the community or one girl in the community is not having this proactive approach, they're not controlling their gaze, they're looking at each and everywhere, they are falling into the conversation with each and every individual, and then eventually, this thing is natural, first of all. The love is very natural. Though we don't talk and we don't give Jummah Khutbah on these sabi, but love is very natural. If you feel an attractive opposite gender, if you see an attractive opposite gender, you will feel kuch kuch hota in your stomach. That's okay, that's very natural. Don't see kuch kuch hota hai, that's not what I'm saying. But you will feel something in your belly. And that's actually very much in line with Islam, because Allah wants to test you. Allah wants to test me. If there is no attraction, then why Yusuf alayhi salam is Yusuf alayhi salam? Because he denied the attraction. He says, Ma'az Allah, even though he was attracted. Then no, I can't do this haram. There is an attraction between opposite gender. And Allah has put that in our heart so that we can use that in halal way too. To enjoy, and at the same time we can increase our generation and so forth. So that's something which is there. But at the same time, Allah will test our emotions and obedience to Him through this. So we cannot deny, it's undeniable fact. But now what we have to do, Allahu Akbar, I don't know who's calling me. Where I was, subhanAllah, I saw the name of the person and yeah, attraction. So now let's say if now one guy and one girl, they are attracted and they didn't pay attention to this. And they fell into the conversation, and then eventually they thought it's now love or infatuation or whatever they are in. Now what to do? We don't talk about these things in usually in Muslim communities, as Imam Uthman was saying, because we think that other issues are more important. But wallahi, after working with the youth, he's mashallah very young, ask us, we can tell you how much Muslim youth are engrossed in these problems of girlfriend-boyfriend relationship, and because they didn't get right mentorship, they were going to make some bad decisions of their life. What they have to do if they're emotionally attached? The best thing you can say, oh no, nikah. But before the nikah, are you ready for the nikah? Are you ready for the marriage? So before we can think of, let's say if you are emotionally attached, then what? First of all, do you know what emotional attachment is?
Love,
but what is love? Because serious emotional attachment, that Imam is reciting Fatiha and you're thinking about Fatima. That's emotional attachment. You cannot think, mentally you are disabled. By the way, Fatima is the name of my daughter, that's why I use don't think personally, or please don't take any offense from my conversation, please. Okay, so now how to guide this couple who are maybe having haram relationship or they are interested in each other, what to do? The first thing I would say before I can suggest them the M word, that's marriage, I would tell them few things. First, make a checklist. Make a checklist. First checklist, is my age appropriate? Because this can happen to 14, 15 year olds. You know, it's a funny thing. One time I gave Eid Khutbah in New Jersey, and after, I mentioned in the Khutbah that quit all the haram relationships. That's one of the signs that you have, that Allah have accepted your fast and so forth. So one young guy called me and he said, Imam, I love your khutbah. I need you to help me. I quit my relationship. Now I need you to help me in marriage. I said, okay. In conversation, I asked, what's your age? He said, I'm 14 years old. And I'm like, that's what my reaction that I first heard. And then I said, okay, I was optimistic. So I said, what's her age? So he said, that's 13 years old. I'm not arguing about the halal haram thing. I'm arguing about the... first of all, the financial responsibility is there in Islam also. You are barely in high school and you are thinking about the about marriage. And secondly, when we think of Fatima and Aisha radiallahu anhuma, those people, they got married in young age. They were mature because of the environmental factor. They can take care of the entire house. Khalid bin Walid, Ali ibn Abi Talib, they can do a lot of things. And when they were 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. Our young guys are just, even though they are 20, they are playing PS3. There is no age for the marriage, by the way. But there is this mental maturity which you have to see that I'm mentally enough, responsible enough, financially responsible, then make a decision. So that's one of the things. Is my age appropriate? And there is no appropriate age, but just mental maturity and financial responsibility is there, then make a decision. If your parents are supporting you in terms of financial, then mental responsibility is there. Because sometimes parents will do this. That okay, don't do zina. Just go, we're going to support you. But make sure you are mentally mature enough to handle the responsibilities of marriage, because it's a complete different science. Let's say that's the first question in your checklist. Second, are we compatible in few things? Let's say in the educational goals, if you are first year in medical student and your parents are not financially supporting you, then it's very unlikely for 7, 8, 9 years you will be student. How are you going to get married if you will not get any financial support? So instead of getting emotionally attached or going forward, you have to make some strong decision for your life, because it will going to distract you from education also. Or change your career and then get married. It cannot happen. Otherwise, it will end up in divorce, because financial and all these things are one of the biggest reasons why the divorces are happening in our community. And then just like this, you have to make the checklist. And if you get the answer right, then you can convey the message to her that, okay, whatever you're doing, it's haram. Or maybe I'm interested in you at the first stage. Let us think about the word marriage. Maybe let's make a plan, engagement, after 6 months nikah, after 6 months let's do the walima and ruksati, qatbul kitab and so forth, or let's do it together, whatever your plan is, whatever your plan is. But based on that, make a plan. But if you don't get the checklist ready, don't move forward. Just because you are infatuated and she's the most beautiful and you are the most cool, don't do that. Because obviously checklist is not there. And there are some important ingredients are missing from the checklist. Let's say if you will convey to her that, oh, I don't want to have it any haram relationship now, or girlfriend, I heard Imam Asif talk and actually we have to quit and we have to make it halal. And she says, no, it's not possible. I was just having a friendly relationship with you. Or she asked him and he said the same thing. Then what to do at that time? Then you have to make some tough decision and leave her or leave him. You know, there's famous scholar Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. I guess you have all heard his name, Ibn al-Qayyim. He wrote a book on this topic, Rawdatul Muhibbin, on this topic, love and infatuation. And he said, in the final part of his book, Man taraka mahbuba haraman fawaddala lahu halalan. The person who leaves his girlfriend or boyfriend for the sake of Allah, Allah will going to give him or her a better substitute in a halal way. And actually he gave the example of Yusuf alayhi salam. When Yusuf alayhi salam denied the proposal given to him for a haram thing, see what Allah gave to him. Allah made him king, Allah gave him wealth. He was already good looking, what else he could ask for? He can get whatever he wants. So Allah will going to give you, inshallah, but you have to just wait. Just make this decision and then wait for Allah's help, inshallah. And then obviously we have to ask whether we should like this person who came in my life 6 months back, or whether I should love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more, who is giving me everything in my life. So you have to do the comparative analysis by being rational and just make some strong decisions, because that's destroying your dunya, that's destroying your akhirah also. Okay. Just the last few things about the love marriage and arranged marriage. And there is a most common question which is being asked, but since you didn't ask, I will not mention that, leave it. So love marriage versus arranged marriage. And then we'll take Q&A inshallah, if you have any. We are already taking questions and so many questions, mashallah. So there are few ways Muslims can get married in this country. Not legally speaking, ethically speaking, or technically speaking. One way is obviously arranged marriage. Second is love marriage. No matter how much conservative people hate, love marriage is happening in Muslim community. No matter how much liberal people hate, arranged marriage is happening in Muslim community. And then there is a sub-branch of arranged marriage that you are going to get someone from Pakistan or India or Egypt. That's even happening. And then there is a new recent development on online method, ShadiOnline.com, RishtaAunty.com, ShadiUncle.com, whatever the websites are. Yeah, don't Google it right now, bro. Don't Google it. Okay, I don't know who was doing. I was just doing this to grab your attention. In terms of love marriage, some conservative people ask, is it okay to use the word love marriage? First of all, what is love marriage? If you ask this question to a guy in Pakistan or Yemen or Egypt or Somalia, they might tell you different things, that a guy and a girl met in McDonald's or Pathan Chai restaurant, and then they will decide, okay, let's get married. That might be Pakistani or Saudi love marriage. They'll do a few haram things. If you ask people, local people here, local, they will say, we do certain things, we live for certain years, 10, 15, we might have kids, and then we'll get married. That's love marriage here. So there's no one definition, it's an ambiguous word for different culture. Is it clear? So now, how can we make it compatible with Islamic values, as I just told you a few values? So yeah, we can use Islamic love marriage term if these things are there. First thing, there is a hadith in Ibn Majah that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that for two people who love each other, the best thing is marriage. That's a hadith, by the way. Sahih. Now there is an indication in this hadith that you can just like in Urdu we say pasand ki shadi, love marriage. That's even permissible in Islam. If you like someone, don't do anything haram, just move forward with the marriage. If you see someone in Muslim community, if you see someone in college, in your MSA or whatever, just don't move forward with haram. Just obviously there is a point of knowing each other, and that's a different topic. That's a fiqh of marriage, not fiqh of gender interaction. That will take me again 2-3 hours to tell you. But generally, that's even mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The intention is to stay away from zina. If you like someone, do marriage. If not, arrange marriage. But as long as the marriage comes, whether love or arrange, it becomes halal. Just keep this in mind. So first thing is love marriage. How it can be applied in America, the first way it can be applied is that if a guy and a girl, they are living haram life, and then all of a sudden they start, oh no, we have to make it halal, that is even Islamic love marriage. They would say, oh, actually we did Islamic love marriage. The other way of doing it, let's say if my daughter and your son, they are studying in UConn, and then they are interacting with each other, halal interaction for their project, for everything, but they started liking each other because they are human beings. They are not angels who don't have desires. They are human beings, and they won't go in any haram thing. They would come to us, or they were going to communicate that, okay, we have to get married. We can't do anything haram. That's even Islamic love marriage. Who's saying that's haram? And the person is saying haram, but he don't have any evidence for it. So that can be even categorized as Islamic love marriage. So there are different flavors for Islamic love marriage. There are different pros and cons also. But again, my topic is on the fiqh of marriage. But I will tell you, or if I would have told you then the pros of the love marriage and the cons of the love marriage in terms of the after effects of the marriage. Okay, in terms of arranged marriage, one term which is confused is forced marriage versus arranged marriage. So forced marriage is not permissible. I don't have to tell you any other hadith, the rights of right of individual. And then there are numerous ahadith and our text and our scholar says forced marriage is not permissible. Especially this happens with daughter most of the times. So your son or your daughter, your right is only to suggest them. You cannot select and say, okay, you are getting married after Salatul Isha, by the way. You know this, right? You can't do that. It's their right. Let them decide. Yeah, you can suggest them that I personally think this guy is better for you. I personally think this girl is better for you. But if they are not making decision, unfortunately or fortunately, marriage counselor also. I've taken few certifications. So I know that most of the divorces within first or second year happen because parents are involved and they will force their decision whether son or daughter to get married. And then they don't want to get married. This is because of family pressure. And after 1 or 2 years, they will going to retaliate that it's your decision. I didn't like her. I didn't like him. So don't do that. But yeah, arranged marriage. You know, some young Muslims here in America, they have this rebellious mindset when they heard arranged marriage. They say, no. I mean, we won't do arranged marriage. It's weird. How can you live with that person without knowing? So keep your options open. Don't have that I will going to have an I'm only going to have love marriage or whatever Islamic love marriage. Keep your options open because we are living in a minority. If you keep your options closed, how will you get married? So if you see someone within your family, if you see someone within your close family members, or your parents are suggesting someone whom do you think it's compatible, don't say just because the word arranged marriage is coming or just because it's coming from the parents it have to be haram or it have to be something bad. Just keep the options open and consider that person, and maybe inshallah you will have that person as a spouse. So keep your options open. But again, it has pros and cons, both how it can affect your marriage, but obviously I don't have time for that. Unless you will ask a question, I will mention briefly then. One way Muslims are getting married in this country is actually online, which is very real. Maybe we say, not my son, not my daughter. You don't know how many sons and daughters, my son and my daughter are going to register on ShadiOnline.com without our knowledge. Because there is a frustration. So I would just say one thing, that it's not haram, but make sure you are staying away from the deception of online, because there are, you don't know who is on the other side, and there are a lot of deception, but there are a few successful stories also. So make sure you trust that matrimonial committee, whether it's by masjid or online, any other masjid or so forth, but make sure you do a thorough research and inquiry before. Because premarital laws is one of the big reason why our kids are getting divorced. Okay. One thing before I can end. I'm saying one thing. This is the last thing. Because I brought this up. You know, one of the things, one of the goals of Islam is to protect individual from zina. That's why these gender interaction guidelines are there. That's why these marriage thing is there. Islam made nikah easy. What we did actually, we made nikah harder, so obviously zina became easy. You know, if the river is flowing, if you will build a dam, it's a right way to give a right flow to river. But if you try to build a wall to stop the flow of river, what you will do? Just explode it. That's what we are doing with the zina and nikah thing. There are few reasons which are legitimate to delay the nikah. Like if the guys aren't financially responsible and the family is not supporting, how he can support my daughter? But at the same time, to have the definition of financial support is that you must have to have 150k income and so forth. That's a lame excuse. Most of the parents have that. There are few most common reason of delay in the marriages in America I have seen. It's about the education, it's about so on and so forth. But the biggest one I would see is that ethnic racism. You know, we hate certain politicians. I won't take the name because of their racist speeches, but sometimes we have the problem of racism within ourselves. You know, there's this joke in Arabic. I don't know whether this joke will make you laugh or not. This is a joke of ulama, so that's a very dry joke. When a person went to a dark room, the word for light is nur and the word for darkness is zulmat or zulm. So he went to a dark room And the name of that house was Baitun Nur, House of Light. But it was very dark. So he says, Izakana Nurukum Hakaza Fakifa Zalamukum. He says that this is Nur, although it's so dark. What about the darkness? So if we have problem within ourselves, how can we point out fingers on other politicians that, oh, you want it? We have the same problem, man. You know, we are living in a minority. Everyone agree? Maybe 1-3%. 3% according to the last survey, but 1% who are announcing themselves and who are contributing Muslim community, let's say. So we are living in a super minority already. And on top of that, you are not living like in Pakistan where every other neighbor is Sattar, Jabbar, Ghaffar. You're living in Connecticut or Danbury or Windsor where your neighbor is John and Prasad, and one time you will find Ahmad. But that Ahmad will be Ahmadi, so it's not an option for you also. So there is a super minority. And then on top of that, you have the restriction that no, we have to find someone within our country origin or within this. That is going to reduce the marriage idea for your kids so much. And then we have other criteria which are legit, that we need practicing Muslim, we don't need this, we don't need that. So eventually no one will left if you're going to have this restriction. At least be open for, I am from Pakistan, but my kids will be American. You are from India, but your kids will be American. What's wrong with if they are getting married, if they want to do something halal? I know it will help. I know it will help, and you will bring someone from your own culture. In terms of language barrier, in terms of cultural knowledge, it will help a lot. You don't have to teach them basic things, but not at the expense of zina. I want to find someone within my culture and let them do zina. And there is no end of this, by the way. Let's say I have two kids, Fatima and Hibban. I will end with this, inshallah. So Hibban is right now 3 years old. Let's say if he becomes 20, you going to UConn, he will come to me. So you come, Abba, I saw this sister and I want you to talk to her father. I want to get married. I said, very good, mashallah. Before I can talk to her father, tell me, where is she from? She was born here. But where is her father from? Oh, they are from Egypt. No, beta, we are Desi. We are to find someone Desi. You know, that's not permissible in Islam. Just go. After a month, he will come, Abba, this time I found a Desi. I said, okay, tell me. This is a Bangladeshi sister. Before 1971, it was okay for Pakistani Bangladeshi to get married. But after, it's a makruh, if not haram. So find someone within Pakistan, beta. Just go. After a month, he will say, Abba, this time I found Pakistani sister. Okay, first, is she from Karachi? No, she's from Lahore. Oh, no. Just find someone from the origin of Karachi. And then eventually the language. I'm from Gujarat, Pakistan, Gujarati origin, and then Karachi. And then eventually there is no end. There is no end of this. You need to be open-minded. I recently actually counseled one case where the guy and a girl was having haram relationship for 7 years. 7 years. And they wanted to have halal relationship, and the mother of guy, they both were from originally Lahore, Pakistan. They were both born in Israel. Their parents were originally from Lahore. Both are from Lahore. But the mother of the guy was saying, no, they are not from our caste. There's no... So it means that everything is halal about the zina. There's no restriction of ethnic racism. But it only applies and they want to make it halal. So Iban will say, Abba, you are saying no to Egyptian, no to Bangladeshi, no to Lahori sister.